I never heard of pulmonary hypertension before until I was diagnosed.
I had to learn about this because I've never ever heard of it.
Pulmonary arterial hypertension is a complex disease, and perhaps diseases that result in the uncontrolled buildup of vascular tissue in the arteries of the lungs. The arteries are narrowed, they're thickened, there's extracellular material in its wall. We don't have a cure. We do know from studies done over the years that a vasoactive substance, endothelin, its concentrations are increased in patients with pulmonary arterial hypertension. That nitric oxide levels are reduced, that prostacyclin levels are reduced. We don't know if any of these are the causative process that set the disease off. This may just be a consequence of the changes that have taken place in the pulmonary arteries, but they're real and they're relevant because these observations have led to the development of the therapies that we have at this point in time. All of these changes, the elevation of endothelin, the reduced nitric oxide, the reduced prostacyclin, they result in narrowing of the pulmonary arteries. That increases the resistance to blood flow. That increases the work that the right ventricle has to do. That increases the pressure that the right ventricle has to generate to force blood through the pulmonary vessels. That results in pulmonary hypertension. And all of the other consequent changes that lead to the symptoms and to the alterations in the function of the right side of the heart.
I was reading and looking at how it affects not only all the majority of people, but how it affects African American people. I said, oh my God, I got really concerned, you know, because what I was reading was saying that, you know, that because of our lifestyles, our behaviors, that we have a heart, maybe having a, it's more difficult, not only to treat, but more difficult to get diagnosed.
Hi there, I'm Dr. Akaya Smith. I'm a pulmonary hypertension specialist at the University of Pennsylvania. And pulmonary hypertension can happen to anybody. It can happen to people of all walks, races, genders, but it certainly does affect the African American community. One of the things that the data shows is that patients who are African American are late to diagnosis. Their doctors miss it, they present later, so certainly they are getting diagnosed much later than they should be. The other thing the studies show is that they are not living as long, living as well as patients who are not African American. And that may have to do with issues of patient compliance taking their medications, but it also may have to do with how soon their doctor diagnoses it, how hard we push to get you on the right medications, how aggressive we are with the therapy. So I think that there are certainly areas that we can improve both at the diagnostic level and the treatment level to improve outcomes in African Americans.
I grew up, you know, watching my family, some of them having high blood pressure, you know, and so I was always conscious of how I ate. But what I came to realize that with pulmonary hypertension was the water retention. You know, and so now all of a sudden I'm swelling up and didn't understand why, and then finding out that one of the symptoms is this water retention. And so then I had to be so careful now about my salt intake.
One of the key parts of treating pulmonary hypertension is not just making the diagnosis and choosing the right drugs, it's also changing some lifestyle things that affect how you do your pulmonary hypertension. The biggest challenge is always salt management. Fluid overload is a part of pulmonary hypertension. It makes you sicker. And what we find is that the salt consumption and the fluid retention in the African-American community is quite high, and higher than in most other populations. Being able to change that diet is a big part of being able to make the patient healthier. So certainly there's a problem here with getting to the doctor on time, paying attention to your symptoms, and making sure you get to the doctor, and not waiting 6 months. And then once we get to the diagnosis, making sure we push just as hard on managing your other diseases, and most especially managing salt consumption and fluid consumption.
Well, I was first diagnosed in 1996.
Wow.
And that was the year that my daughter was born. And I try not to associate that, because I never want her to feel as though she was a result of, you know, she this happened to mommy. But at any rate, I remember tax season was April 15th. I had Brianna on the 19th. And maybe 2 or 3 months after that, I started feeling really tired. Actually, I felt tired throughout my pregnancy. Because I was commuting from New York to New Jersey. So I started feeling tired, but everyone associated with being pregnant. And so I guess 2 or 3 months after I gave birth, I started retaining water and just started really having a hard time. So I was going to go back to work in September. And throughout the entire summer, things just got progressively worse. And no one could figure out exactly what was going on. And people would look at me, and they would look at my feet, and they were like, oh my God, something's going on, you better get treatment. And, you know, the doctors were trying to figure out, you know, what was wrong. And I tried going back to work around September, and I noticed that I could no longer walk up the stairs going into New York. It just became very laborious, okay. I never forget running on a train in Dunellen, and I actually ran up the stairs, and I sat down, and I started coughing and just gagging, and you know, the conductor asked me, was I okay? And so I guess those were just signs that I just couldn't breathe. And I'll never forget that evening, one of my coworkers walked me to Penn Station, and Susan was her name. She was really concerned about me. And I couldn't walk. So I called my husband, and I told him to meet me at the train station. And he did. I told you the tears. So I was seeing a doctor then. And she went on vacation, and I had been started to experience severe edema at the time. So the lady who was covering for her told her what my symptoms were, and she told me to come right in, and I did. And it was so funny, that was her second week at that particular office, Dr. Goldstein. And I went in, and she just looked at me. She started examining me, and she's looking at this swollen body full of fluid, and she told me to go home and pack a bag. And so I was frightened to death. I didn't know what was going on. So she sent me to JFK. I went and had a test run, and she told me she thinks that I have what's called pulmonary hypertension.
How long did it take you to identify that your ailment was PH?
I guess a little over 2 years ago. I started out with rheumatoid arthritis, and they put me on methotrexate. And after being on that a couple of years, they discovered that I had scarring on my lung caused by the methotrexate, and my journey started.
And so when you say your journey started, what do you mean by that?
I started noticing a definite shortness of breath, getting tired easily, and then went on different medications, And it just went from one thing to another. And about 20 months ago, I went to the hospital. And I went downhill. You know, I was knocking on the door. And they told me to come back because they weren't ready.
Alicia, when he was first diagnosed, like before he was diagnosed, did you notice anything about him? Did you notice, other than like he's talked about the shortness of breath, but what did you notice?
He started having swelling in his hands and in his feet, mostly in his hands. Fluid started building up, and I suggested to him that he needed to call the doctor ASAP because that's not something usual. So it was affecting his heart, which meant fluid was building up in too many places that was incorrect. And we went to the emergency room, and of course they did their normal of administering Lasix and different things to take the fluid out. We came back home. By that evening he had another episode where he felt his breathing was not correct. We called the ambulance and we went right back to the same situation all over again.
So hearing when I first was diagnosed, you never really understand what it means to have pulmonary hypertension. I mean, I know that what I felt, but you never know how that's going to affect your life and what your new normal is going to become like. I was a very physical person, playing paddleball in New York and, you know, hitting killers and just running around. And I could no longer do that. And I remember before being diagnosed, my husband and I, you know, we would do things together. He's athletic too. And I could no longer do that. So, emotionally, it to me, it places certain limits on what you can do, and I became more fearful about going, especially when I got the line. I became really fearful about going places. If something happens, are they going to know how to treat me? If this thing breaks, I knew that it was a trip to the emergency room. We spent many nights en route to New York Presbyterian because they were the only ones who really knew how to handle this, you know, infections and stuff.
I was diagnosed with pulmonary hypertension in 2010, and it was in addition to another condition that I have, scleroderma. Pulmonary fibrosis had occurred from the disease, and the pulmonary hypertension has to be checked like every couple of years, and I started running out of air, and then my pressures were shown that I was borderline pulmonary hypertension and I needed to use oxygen more often.
So some of the symptoms that you had, a pH, was that shortness?
With everything, just sitting.
Sitting? Shortness
and,
of breath?
Yeah, shortness of breath and bending over to do normal things like getting dressed, housework, and then eventually I just was out of breath a lot, even working, so I had to let them know that my breathing seemed to be getting worse.
There are certainly other diseases that run in the African-American community that can change and can confuse the diagnosis. Things like sarcoidosis, which is more common in African-Americans, can cause a form of pulmonary hypertension, but it also causes interstitial lung disease, and we have to be able to sort that out, which one it is. There are certain skin findings on patients that sometimes it's easier to see when your skin is not dark. And so sometimes we're not as attuned to looking for blood vessels that are dilated or tightening of the skin, changes that can help clue us in early to diseases are running before pulmonary hypertension or with pulmonary hypertension. And so there's certainly lots of things that make this population harder to find, harder to treat, but also that we can do a better job.
When I went to the doctor, they did not diagnose it at first. They had said that I had pneumonia, and that's what they was treating me for, was the pneumonia. And I was hospitalized twice for pneumonia. Again, I believe that it was difficult for them to diagnose in the beginning, because now that I think about it, that I had symptoms maybe for about 2 to 3 years. I was running back and forth to the hospital or to the doctor, and I had the treadmill test, you know, and everything would come back that I was okay, that my heart was fine. So, and I even remember going to a concert, a jazz concert, and sitting in the jazz concert, and all of a sudden I got dizzy. And then the dizziness resulted, I went upstairs, and they told me I was fine, that it was just heat exhaustion. Then I also remember at church, that I was sitting in church one day, and I could not catch my breath. And so when I went in the back to where the nurses' stations was, they called the ambulance or the paramedic, and they came and got me. And I was in the hospital for a few days. And again, they said my heart was fine. So they were looking for my heart, something wrong with my heart, instead of looking at the pulmonary hypertension. So it wasn't until, like I said, maybe two to three years later, that when the symptoms reappeared at such a so strongly, and it wasn't until February of 2013 that I finally got diagnosed with it.
Just listening to what happens with this pressure, how they really can't always stop it, they do what they can. I actually thought that I wouldn't be around in 5 years, but you know, it was very, very intimidating. I was very overwhelmed, crying. I was a long distance runner, so hearing news that, you know, you can't breathe, and I was running, you know, running in competitively in high school and college, and saying you can't breathe and you have to use oxygen, I actually thought maybe this was it for me. And I was only, you know, I was 40 years old when this PH diagnosis came in addition to the scleroderma. I'm like, wow, what else is going to happen to me?
I remember being in a holding pattern at JFK because no one had ever heard of this disease before. They didn't know how to treat me. So for 2 days, I was admitted, and them trying to figure out what to do, and doctors walking in, looking at me, shaking their head, and just looking completely baffled. So eventually, may not have been 2 days, but it felt that way. So eventually, Dr. Goldstein talked to her colleagues over at New York Presbyterian, and I see that commercial today, and it says great things are happening here. I can really relate to that. But they ambulanced me to New York Presbyterian with my mother, my husband, and my daughter in tow following me. So we got there, and all these doctors just started coming in and out and looking at me and, you know, talking about me, and you could see them huddling in circles and just trying to figure this out. So I was introduced to Dr. Horn at the time, and she came in and she told me who she was, and she was the specialist in pulmonary hypertension, and she explained what it was, and it was just so overwhelming.
Well, I learned from when you have pulmonary hypertension, you have to deal with several doctors, because you have your primary doctor who wants to know what the rheumatologist is doing, what the pulmonologist is doing, and sometimes it's hard to know who to listen to as far as what you need to take as far as medications and also testing. I think the hardest part, PH, is the testing. Other than the breathing test, the right side catheterization can be very intimidating because, you know, they're going through your groin up to your heart, and then you're wondering what's going to happen as you're laying on the table, like what type of pressure they're going to find.
It's rough. I'm used to being a very active person, and I can't be now. Anything physical wipes me out. And I have to sit there for 5 minutes just to gather myself. So I am a little more than a vegetable physically. I work out a little bit, then it wipes me out. Then I'd be afraid to work out because of because of what happened. So I can't sit and do nothing. I mean, just that bothers me more than the actual illness. So I wash the dishes, or I do a little stuff around here, and my wife get mad at me. I have to bring something to the table. I can't just be here gathering. I guess that's the biggest effect it's been for me.
Mm. How about for you? Any change too? I hear what Willie's been going through.
Considering Willie is very disciplined about having things in order, it is difficult because when you used to your mate working with you hand in hand, we no longer can, you know, put on a big party. We were entertaining because a lot of times that now will fall all on me opposed to both of us working together. Anytime we entertain, we clean the kitchen up together. You know, we never left each other out there to do it by, you know, yourself. Once he retired, I got a little used to him being home and just taking over some normal house duties, you know. So now, again, that's fallen back into my territory of making sure things are done at night, making sure he has his meds, you know, reminding him to take his meds. So you're adding more things into your daily than that was not there before. And on down to cleaning the front yard, removing of snow, even though we have friends and neighbors that do help, which is a blessing. It's a lot when, you know, your individual spouse was normally the one that took care of all the heavy duty things. And now we kind of somewhat reverse roles.
But it was an emotional journey. There was even times when my friend Tony would have to come and get me out of the house because all I wanted to do was sit in the house. I was just scared. I was scared to go out because I couldn't breathe. I was just scared. I had oxygen. They had given me oxygen at that time. I didn't know how to use it. It was just a frightening time.
I flew one time, and I was so afraid because they would pull me to the side, and they would have to swab down my pump and stuff. It was just an ordeal. And I was always afraid. We used to go to North Carolina to visit my husband's parents. And I was always so afraid of getting sick down there because no one would know how to treat me. So, you know, it was always, you know, that fear, you know, and then not wanting people to know. So I didn't really reach out to people other than my immediate family. So I guess over a period of time, you know, you just become locked into your box, your little four corners of your world, you know.
In the African American community, access to health care is an issue due to the cost. So a lot of individuals tend to put their aches and pains on the back burner. In the meantime, they're becoming symptomatic.
Like most people, I didn't go to the doctor. I'm like, I can't afford to do a $15, $20 copay. They're going to see me every 2 weeks. I said, that's a lot of money. Wait, every month? I can't afford that. And so like most people, I blew it off. I said, I'm feeling okay. And then medication costs, the copays, very, very expensive. And that's in addition to all of your other life bills. So I can see why people would not go to the doctor, but when you're not feeling good, not having financial should be the last, because I know when I did have this financial issue come, I dealt with it. I was on disability, so I had to wait 2 years and pay my own COBRA insurance, which was way more than the average. I was paying over $1,000 a month for 2 years till I was accepted in Medicare. So when people say, oh, just go on disability if you don't feel good, I can see why people try to hang in there, because if you're knowledgeable about the wait time to get covered with Medicare, you would know how hard it is. And that's on top of all the medications. And with the coverage I had, one of my medications was $800 a month. So because I developed a lung infection, and I can't get that like any of us. And so financially, it's very hard. And and having to dip into, you know, things you never, and it's like I had an IRA account, thank God, because I had to use it to help me for 2 years because, you know, I was spending all the money I had just to take care of my basic care for medicines and having insurance. So it's very tough.
One of the things that people didn't share that I wish they had told me was the financial strain that this having this disease had caused, because I didn't know. And I remember in the early parts of it, I was running to the doctors 2 and 3 times a week, and each of those were co-pays. Even though I had insurance, it was still co-pays, you know, that I had to pay out. So you think about my co-pay to see a specialist maybe was about $30, $40 each time. So that's what that 4 times 3 is, $120. And so I was winding up spending quite a bit of money between the co-pays and the medications, going to not only the specialist, but having different tests, diagnostic tests. And I had reached a place where it was taking a toll on me paying my bills.
Learning how to deal with using oxygen at work, and also when I'm going out with people, I even asked my family and friends, does it bother you that you have to walk around with someone like me? Because everyone's staring at us, which to me is amazing that people stare, because you have, you know, a device that everyone has seen hanging. But I think because you don't see a lot of people wearing it out in public, so I wonder if that shame is like, that's why you don't. People don't want to wear it out in public, so people aren't used to it. So I was self-conscious for like in my 40s, but you know, I was like, this is part of my accessories now. I wish I could decorate it for the holidays, because this is part of what I have to wear, right? Instead of having to wear lipstick and whatever, you know, things you need, you know, you need to, it's what I have as a part of me. So at the beginning, yes, but now I'm very comfortable with it, and it opens up questions. I get to teach people a lot about why I have to use oxygen.
That's so much want to be normal. And I remember the pump was about this size, and I first had to wear it. It was this black pump, and I kept asking them, don't you have colors, you know? And they kept saying, oh no, this is, you know, all we have. So it had this black pump, the pouch was this long, and it had to go around my waist, and you had to keep it on ice. So I had these ice packs, and in the summer they would start melting, and I had to constantly change them. And people would see this pump around my waist and this wetness. And they would ask me, oh God, what is that? You know, and I have pulmonary hypertension. Oh my God, what's that? And you know, just a whole new story in itself.
Chronic illness can cause all kinds of stigmas. And for me, having it, wearing the oxygen it just affected my self-esteem. It had kind of lowered it, because now I had this thing on my face that I had to wear. And people, I don't believe people were being malicious or anything, but they stare at you, you know, or, you know, they may come up and ask you what that is, why you're wearing that. I know that it was so bad at one time that I wouldn't even go to church, you know, because of it. And it just produced shame. You just felt so, so, so shameful of having to wear this oxygen. Now what happened was that, how I got over it was that I recognize, number one, that this doesn't define who I am. You know, it's just something that I need in order for me to breathe. So that was number one. Number two, I saw people in the support group who had, they were fully made up and they had their lipstick on and they just looked good with it, you know. And so I looked at them and I said, wow, you know. And then the third thing was that I can use this as a teaching tool. So when people come up to me now and ask me, if I see them staring at me, I tell them that's my opportunity to tell them, oh, the reason why I'm wearing this is because I have pulmonary hypertension. And then I give them I just share a little bit what pulmonary hypertension is, which is high blood pressure in the lungs.
Finding a support group, I know that has been one of the best things that's happened to me, is that I've gone to a support group with pulmonary hypertension. A group, a special community that we are in, but it is, because you know when you're talking to someone, they totally understand the doctor stuff, the medicine stuff, and the sometimes depression, and it's good not to be alone and to, you know, think that, you know, I gotta do this by myself. The support groups are a very big support emotionally, mentally, physically. I'm glad I joined one.
Michael, my husband, told me, he said, Vanita, you need to find somebody else like who could, you know, like you. And so he had me looking online for just support groups or whatever. And that's when I found the Pulmonary Hypertension Association. And I was able to find a support group. And I went there, and it was just so amazing to walk in there and see people like me. And then when I'm sitting in the support group, I remember just bursting out crying, because I had read on the research, and on the internet they said the lifespan was just like once you found out you had a 3-year lifespan. And so I'm like, okay, you know, what do I do with that? But then when I went to the support group, I saw people who had pulmonary hypertension for 10 years, 15 years, and they were just telling me how that it was going to be okay, you know. And so I remember leaving there, and Mike was sitting there waiting for me, and I told him, he said, how did you make out? I said, I finally feel like I'm going to be okay.
I think, other than the doctors and the literature that we received, the support group that you head up has been my best friend. I never believed in them before, but I found out that we need each other. You know, because when you talk to people that have not gone through this, they can empathize with you, sympathize, tell you how much they understand. Unless you've been through it, you just don't understand.
Right.
And when you talk to people who are going through the same journey, they have challenges that you have that you didn't know that you could take care of. They've done things that you have not. You share information, you share literature, and it makes your journey just a little bit easier.
The Pulmonary Hypertension Association had a walk, and this was... So I was diagnosed in February, and they had a walk in September. And I went to that walk, and Mike was with me, and my girlfriend Tony was there with me. And they had so much information about pulmonary hypertension on the table. I mean, so many flyers and everything else, giving really good information about it. And so from there, I got information more about it. Then also, attending their conferences, I gained information. So it was, the research just went in so many different directions. Again, using the internet, I even used social media. You know, they had a support group on social media, on Facebook, that I was able to just post on it whenever I had questions or whatever. And so I did that. But in all of this, one of the things I remember at the first support group that I went to, they talk about you have to become an advocate for yourself.
It's unbelievable. I saw people in the hospital with nobody. They were just laying there. And I remember saying to the nurse, "Some people are really sick." She looked at me and laughed. She said, "You were the sickest person in the hospital." I said, "I didn't know." She said, "Yeah." She said, "But there were so many people coming here praying for you." I had churches from Maine to Florida praying for me. Okay? Yes. My church prayed for me. How can God not listen? You know, just, it's the difference between success and failure to have a good support group. And it's not a journey I would recommend. But the lessons I've learned from the journey are invaluable. You know, it's my journey. Everybody has their own journey. And this pastor said, if you ain't have one, keep on living.
Mm-hmm. Once that, I got that Remodulin, that was like a whole new drug for me. And you know, but I could see God over time just intermingled and had his little finger in all this. You know, even with the diagnosis, most people are not diagnosed for years and years and years. And I, you know, you figured I had my daughter in April, and I was diagnosed in October. And just the idea that the doctor who couldn't find out what was wrong, she went on vacation, and her, the doctor that was covering for her took over and diagnosed me. So I knew God was there, you know, and it was a real faith walk, you know. And I can look back now, and I see it. It's just unfolds, even to this day. You know, my husband said to me the other night, he said, "Wow, look at you." You know, he said, "Look how far you've come." And I said, "Oh my God, I know."
If you don't feel good, you need to go to the doctor. If you don't know how you're going to take care of it financially, or if you need to get in touch with whoever you can, tell people you have no idea what to do, ask for help. So if you're sick, that you can go and get the best medical care right away.
You know, just because you have this disease, don't stop living. Keep living. You know, keep doing the things that you'd like to do as much as possible. Even if it's exercise, just exercise a little bit. If you can't, you know, run a marathon, walk a marathon.
I've learned on this journey that God is good. And that without him, we can do nothing. And that as much as we think we are in control, if you want to make God laugh, tell him what your plans are.
You have to have patience. You have to pray every day, morning, noon if need be, but definitely you have to pray together.
You ask doctors about the medication. You find out how to, what's the side effects of each medication, how is it going to react on your body, and you look for that. You bring somebody to the doctor for your visits and everything.
It's been an emotional journey, but because of my support system, it made it so much easier, you know. And I just just that trust and that faith in God, and just seeing how he works and knowing that he's going to continue. Even now, I know that there's more. You know, even though I don't have very many pH issues now. It's more of an arthritis thing. But I'm starting to just branch out now. And, you know, there's so many things I want to do. There's so much life that I see. I'm looking, I'm saying, okay, 30 years from now, where am I going to be? 40 years from now, where am I going to be? Because I do feel that God has something in store for me. He has kept me all this time. And I'm not sure what it is yet, but I know he's working. And so I'm just thankful. Every day I'm just thankful, you know, and you know, I'm just thankful. That's all I can say.